Hello, and welcome back to Spirituality TV. This is part two with our conversations with Father Mike Butler of the Colorado Springs Diocese in Colorado, who was a former Benedictine monk and priest here at the Benedictine Monastery at Pecos, Our Lady Guadalupe Abbey. He was there for a total of 12 years, and the Lord sent him out to share his gifts with the people of Colorado and around the world, and it's just a blessing to have him. He was here for a men's retreat sponsored by the State Knights of Columbus here in New Mexico for any man that wanted to come, and I was there, and it was just a fabulous do, and the guys were all pretty touched by it. So thanks for coming in and sharing for those who couldn't be there.
Sure.
So as we left, you'll have to see it somewhere, go on the internet, look for part one, but at part two, he left this, by the time you see this, with the was ordained by John Paul II, who just became a saint, and that's a pretty exciting thing. You'll be maybe the first priest anybody said. So what was that experience like for you to be in Rome, you know, after you've been a seminarian, then all of a sudden you're there with John Paul II, and now he's a saint? Can you give us some idea what that was like?
Well, what had happened is 5 months before I was ordained by John Paul II, I was studying in Israel for 5 months. So I was going over the entire Holy Land and experiencing what we call the fifth gospel. Because when you go on the land, then scripture becomes even more three-dimensional. So here my mind and my heart and my spirit were getting filled with all this, and then we journey on to Rome to get ordained. Now, the beautiful thing about it was when I was entering into St. Peter's Square, I had some extra tickets that would provide for anyone with that ticket to go in and see the ordination. So I went around the plaza offering tickets.
Oh, you're scalping it at the Vatican?
Because, you know, the church is open to everyone.
Yeah.
And St. Peter's Basilica is a magnificent place of faith and worship. And for those who haven't been there, regardless what faith you're from, it's a beautiful, magnificent place to visit.
Yeah, I was there 6 years ago on pilgrimage, and it just completely overwhelming. And the other guy that was ordained, I mean, was made a saint with John Paul II, was John the 23rd.
Correct.
At the time, he was on the main floor under glass. I'd never seen a pope under glass before.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
And he'd been underground for 47 years, and he came out, and he looked better than ever. I mean, it was either one or two things. Either Madame Tussaud did her magic, or this guy was incorrupt, and it was a real blessing just to be in his presence.
Oh, yes. Yes, indeed. And it was a blessing to be in the presence of John Paul II alive.
Yeah, man.
So there were 77 priest candidates from around the world that were being ordained, and there are about 6,500 people in the congregation.
6,500.
From around the world.
Yeah, that's a lot.
And, you know, the Catholic Church is called the Universal Church, which represents it is around the world and all are welcome. As a matter of fact, it reminds me, it was just a week or two ago that our president of the United States, Barack Obama, visited the Vatican with our current Pope, Pope Francis. And the first words that Pope Francis said to President Obama was, "You are welcome here." Uh-huh. And he uses those same words universally for anybody of any faith or no faith that comes to the Vatican. And he encourages any Catholic parish throughout the world to express the same hospitality. You are welcome here. So if anybody's considering, please come. We'd love to have you.
That's true. So there you were. Do you remember, I mean, what happens when a bishop, or in this case, the Bishop of Rome and the Pope, literally lays hands on you and then receiving the sacrament of ordination, and so you are now changed forever to the order of Melchizedek. Can you explain that to people? What happens to the man? Who was Mike Butler before, and who did he become at that point?
Okay, well, by the authorization of Christ himself, the church continues the tradition of passing on the presbyterate from you know, one man to the next by the laying on of hands and the ritual and the rite. So in my case, the main altar was just about dead center where we were, and then I was kind of on the left side, and I was looking at the chair of Peter, which represents our first pope. It's a huge chair, and it's a symbolic sign that he has the seat at, you know, at the time. And above that is the window of the Holy Spirit. So for a good time, a portion of the ordination, I was looking over there, and I was praying to the Holy Spirit. And then what happened in my heart and in my mind is when the Pope laid hands on my head, and it was probably about for 10 seconds, 15 at the most, I found myself saying the words, I, now being a priest, will make every liturgy I do a celebration for the people.
Wow. Had you prepared that, or is that what came to mind?
That came to my heart as he laid hands on me.
Wow.
So what happens is he lays hands on you, which is the conferring of the Holy Spirit. And then you go to the altar and you receive Holy Communion from the same altar where the Pope presides. And then they also oil your hands, consecrate your hands, because these hands are going to be used, you know, for the consecration and the blessings, and done hundreds of thousands of times.
That's amazing. Now, just for full disclosure, I actually met Father Mike, then just Brother Mike, at his ordination to the transitional diaconate. I remember this day, it was November 1983.
Mm-hmm.
And I just happened to be, I didn't happen to be there, I begged my way in to he and now Father Paul Meaden, who's been a guest on the show, in that very small chapel at the time at the monastery. I said, there's always room for one more, and there wasn't. All I got in was my head just to watch this, and it was done by then Archbishop Sanchez.
That's correct.
Where now Monsignor Jerome was his assistant, and that was a very touching moment. Can you compare the two? Because that's when you first receive the Sacrament of Holy Orders, is at the ordination of transitional diaconate. Can you compare the two? Were they different?
No, they were parallel. Except for the consecration of the hands.
Uh-huh.
And what they do is they present to you the Gospels book symbolically. Well, we hadn't practiced, so he hands me the Gospel book, and I said, thank you, and I started, you know, because I love the Word, and I started to take it, and then he was grabbing it back, and we were going back and forth, and finally I yielded. But it was such a blessed thing to receive the sacred word and be able to preach and teach on it.
So now I want to ask you about the inner man. I mean, because you had been you've been a monk under vows, and I'm sure those change you too, but this changes you forever. So can you speak to that and how you've experienced God using you sacramentally or just as what they say in persona Christi? I mean, you are now in the person of Christ. When you wear this outfit, you've got your collar, and you're here to serve at any moment, isn't it?
Yeah, I still struggle with that. I've been in this for 30 years, and I see myself as a person, just like yourself, mm-hmm. no different. Mm-hmm. But when I'm on the altars, you use the term in persona Christi, that means that my mouth, my eyes, my body represents Jesus Christ himself. And if I dwelt on that too much, again, it would get to my head,
yeah.
and it wouldn't be doing anybody any good.
Mm-hmm.
So what I've learned to do is just let go, be myself,
yeah.
And whatever the Spirit wants to show the people is fine with me.
Yeah.
But
okay.
I'd rather not get hung up with that, like, oh, I'm somebody so really special. But the fact is, I am.
Yeah.
In the Spirit of God and in that particular ministry.
Mm-hmm. I'd be remiss if I didn't talk about one of my favorite sacraments that's underrated, and that's the Sacrament of Reconciliation.
Yes.
And when I go to you or another priest and I'm just bringing, you know, whatever I'm struggling with, I love the instructions you gave this weekend to me. Forget the laundry list, you know. You're not a little boy anymore. You're not stealing candy bars or doing something like this or fighting with your brother or sister. Or whatever you've done, but I love that instruction when you gave, what was it again?
Well, By the way, this past weekend, I didn't know these guys. I certainly knew them after the retreat. But I was telling them, when somebody tells me, Father, it's been 40 years since my last confession, then I say to them, let's not do the laundry list. Let's do it this way. In your spiritual journey and walk, where have you been? Where are you now? And where would you like to be in your relationship with God? And by the way, one of the retreatants had not been to confession for 40 years.
No kidding. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay. Yeah, you can't, not revealing any secrets, but that's a surprise. But that's what a retreat is for. Maybe this is a good time to explain what the benefit of a retreat is and why we were there.
I would say a retreat is an interruption from our daily lives. There's a term out there that says interruptions are divine instructions. So if one is forced by one's spouse to go to a retreat, most likely it's not going to work. But if they're there, then surprisingly the grace of God just might strike them in a very, very beautiful way. But what it is it's basically God time. It's a time to be quiet. It's a time to turn off the computers, the cell phones, the radios, and to open up the frequency to the direct communication with God. I understand technologically they say that there are all kinds of frequencies out there now with all the broadcasting stuff that's going on from all the media. But we need to tune in with God's frequency, which basically is his voice. So that's what we offer in retreats. First of all, time to relax, time to be quiet, literally quiet. A time to reflect on the scriptures, a time to receive teaching on the scriptures, a time in a Catholic retreat, a time to receive the sacraments, primarily reconciliation, the anointing of the sick, and Eucharist. And it opens the entire being, because we have the head, the heart, the gut. There's the physical, the mental, emotional, the spiritual. And if one of those is out of whack, then it throws the other areas off. So we try to seek balance spiritually, intellectually, holistically, bind body, mind, and soul. And all we do is we try the best that we can, but leave the rest to God, because as Scripture says, what you do is you plant, you water, and you let God do the rest. So, ever so clearly, none of us is God, none of us knows it all. All we're doing is yielding to the specific gifts that God has given us to present, and then leave it to God. So, for example, I told these retreatants, you know, you've been here, you'll be here for a couple of days, but when you leave, this retreat is going to continue on and God will follow up. And all you have to do is be in tune and stay on that straight and narrow as God is calling you to.
Yeah, I noticed when we started off with the sacrament of reconciliation, so you've climbed to clear the decks for action. It's like taking a spiritual shower. Mm-hmm. And you brought whatever's bothering you or hassling you, and you just leave it there, and it's out of you now. And then went to bed the next morning. We had Mass and Communion, so read the body of Christ. And then the church provides for the indulgences that by reading Scripture together. And that was such a pleasure. I've never experienced it before, where each guy got up and just read one of their favorite pieces of Scripture. So it was like, to me, the analogy would be like, you know, instead of watching a whole bunch of football games, I just watched the highlight reel, and it was one highlight after another, and it just was building and building, and you could feel the energy raise in the room, and your heart starting to fill, and it was great. And what happened, you do that for a half an hour, and that's a plenary indulgence, where, as I understand it, that will remove any and all temporal punishment due to sin. So in addition to have your sin and being guilt-free of it, now any punishment that was due was removed, so you're completely free of any weights that you were carrying coming in. So the therapeutic side of that will remain to be seen, but I feel enlivened, I feel renewed, refreshed, and that's why I go. It's a blessing.
Mm-hmm.
So you did a great job, too, of that teaching and helping with it. So for those of you who hadn't seen those, you can see some of the old retreats and talks on the YouTube channel that you might be watching this on. Just look, and you get a chance to see some of those, and I appreciate it. So now, let's talk about that, where we've been, where we are now, and where we're going. Use your own life as an example. I mean, you've been a priest now for 30 years,
mm-hmm.
and you're retired, but it sounds like you're working more than ever. What advice would you have for people out there, say, for instance, who either fallen away Catholics or don't know anything about the Catholic faith? What benefits have you seen from this spiritual practice? If you have none, what's the reason to try this one?
Well, that reminds me way back when last week we were talking about, you know, when I joined the prayer group. And they raised me to a much higher conscious level. Now, by conscious, we mean knowing right from wrong, which is a gift from God, which keeps us spiritually stable. So there was so much coming my way as far as teachings. And finally, one day, I just stopped and knelt before a crucifix. And I bowed, and I said, Lord, I know you were crucified, but I don't know why. Would you please teach me? And that was probably 40 years ago. And to this day, he's still teaching me. So I would say that's the first place to go, is to the crucifix. Now, what the crucifix represents is God's unconditional love for you and me, because he gave up his life freely. He could have, when he was on his pilgrimage to the cross, he could have used his God-given powers and walked around the cross rather than going directly to the cross. But there's another saying that goes, when God leads you to the cross, he leads you through it. So the leading to is the suffering. The leading through is the healing and the glory. So all of us have had mental sickness, emotional sickness, spiritual sickness, and physical sickness. And those are crosses. And we could use any kinds of examples in those four areas. Mm-hmm. But where is our focus? Is our focus on me, poor me, poor me? Or in faith, is our focus on God, who is with us all the time, and that God will bring us through? God never promised us an easy life on this earth. He never promised us that we would be free from pain and suffering. So that's why I'm suggesting that's the starting point. The crucifix, not the cross,
right?
Because you have to have both and.
That's right. Well, let's see, I've got one here. I can demonstrate it, or
okay.
I can show it on this rosary. I don't know if you can get a tight shot on that or not, but this here, we have the corpus on the actual cross itself. Are we getting it, do you think? Anyhow, but this brings up another thing. I'm always remember hearing what Saint Padre Pio said about the rosary. This was actually a weapon. You know, bring me my weapon, because there are evil influences in the world. You just have to read the newspaper every day or listen to the local news, and you'll hear it and see it. But this goes to that, isn't it? Because we're being constantly bombarded with distractions, interruptions, you name it, negative things happening to people, yourself included. And we need to increase our spiritual life to help us through that. Would that a fair thing to say?
Yeah, and I would suggest for people who don't necessarily have a spiritual life, what you can do is you can start in baby steps. If we try to take one big leap, it's not going to work. So for example, when you have an infant, the infant is learning about life through baby steps. And then the child grows day by day by day. And one of the most delightful things to parents is watching that little tyke grow and mature. And I'm not sure if they're too happy when they start walking, because then they really have to be attentive.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, think of your spirituality in baby steps. And if I have somebody whom I'm spiritual directing and they have very little spiritual life, I tell them, we in the Catholic Church, We have a publication called The Word Among Us magazine. And that would be a baby step, because of what it does is it gives you the daily readings that we have in the Mass, and then it has a reflection on the Scripture, and then a daily challenge. So that's a baby step. Mm-hmm. And then as you get into it deeper and deeper and deeper, then you start doing additional things. Now, Bill was mentioning the rosary, that it's our weapon. I have to tell you this, in all the years that I've been in this ministry, now, in the now, the rosary is becoming very, very powerful. I don't know how to measure that, you know, in the spirit, but it seems to me that Mary is really wanting us to pray the rosary more than ever. And we know the power that Mary has in intercession to Jesus Christ for the well-being of humankind. So if anybody else is being led in that direction, you're right on target, I think.
Mm-hmm. And we, one of recent guests, Father Andrew Miles, who we both know, was the second abbot of the monastery in Pecos, recently wrote a book on the rosary that I can strongly recommend, explains everything and how it can be used effectively. But also we mentioned the Mass, mm-hmm. and at the central part of it is the Eucharist. In the few minutes we have left, can you explain how what happens at the Mass, and also I told you, what happens when you lay your hands over that bread and wine and change it into the body and blood of Christ? What's your experience there?
Even to this day, it's scary. Because even though I may not feel anything, and most of the time I don't, I realize that these consecrated hands are consecrating the simple bread and wine into the true body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. And I believe, and the Church teaches, that when we have the Holy Eucharist, that Jesus joins us, and that the angels and saints join us as well at the altar. And I've had some experiences sometimes where I, in my senses, I experience that. The other thing is, you're in the parish that I assist, you're looking at a congregation of about 750 people. And when you raise that host, you can hear a pin drop in that congregation, because their total focus and concentration is on that host, the body of Christ. So it's a very moving, touching experience. And I always think and always teach that the body and blood of Christ is the greatest gift that humanity can receive on this earth. There is nobody that can give humanity anything greater than that. And what that represents, I heard it said one time that when we eat food, you know, the expression, you become what you eat. Mm-hmm. So if you eat a lot of hamburger, you become a cow. So we eat the food, we consume the food. In this case, we eat of the body of Christ, and the body of Christ consumes us. Mm-hmm. And then we become in more likeness and imitators of Jesus Christ in the subtlest baby step ways. Yeah. I had a meditation not too long ago. You know when you take medication via a pill? You take the pill, and all you do is you trust what they said in the instructions. This pill will do this in your body. But you don't feel anything, you don't sense anything, but it's doing the work. When you consume with the precious body of our Lord Jesus Christ, it's very parallel to that, that it is healing us, it is making us more fulfilled in life, and it's empowering us to be Christ around the world through our eyes, our ears, our hands, our mouth.
Yeah, I can tell you my own experience. I wasn't in the church the whole time, and one time when I wasn't, my first time visiting the monastery, I used to be a meditator on a regular basis, so I started meditating in front of the exposed Blessed Sacrament, and I just had my eyes closed and had a very strong meditation. It was going on 10, 15, maybe 20 minutes, And then all of a sudden, I noticed that half the energy disappeared. So I opened my eyes, and the sacristan had taken it and put it back in the tabernacle. And I actually felt that in my meditation. So it is a beacon. It is something generating energy that sensitive people can literally feel, whether you're Catholic or not, so I recommend it. Just in the few minutes I have left, Mike, you want to wrap this up with anything you'd like to say?
Piggybacking off of you, I heard this one time that Pope John Paul II would love to visit the Blessed Sacrament. He would spend hours visiting with the Blessed Sacrament. So there was this one place that he was visiting. I don't know where it was, but there was this long hallway. And one of the Pope's delegation said, "Is there a Blessed Sacrament chapel here?" And they said, "Yes." And they showed the room where it was. And they said, he said, "Don't let the Pope know that this chapel is here, because whenever we go on trips with him, he stops by and he gets us way off schedule." Well, nobody says anything. He's going down this long hallway. There's no way that you would have known that there was a Blessed Sacrament chapel. And he stopped by the door, opened it, and he waved his hands and he said, "Naughty." So
he felt it.
That parallels what you just said.
Yeah, and I've heard it from Liam Hoare, one of the servant generals of the Paracletes, who started here in New Mexico, said that part of their therapy with guys and gals that was to put him in front of, he called it, the cobalt ray of the Eucharist, a couple hours a day just for therapy. Well, listen, we've run out of time. It's been a great second visit with you. We could do this all day, it sounds like. So I want to thank you for coming, and I want to thank you for viewing. I hope anything Father Mike has said to you, encourage you to pursue it, take a look for it. You can find this other programs on the internet or in cable television, wherever you are, I hope. And if you have any comments or questions, our credits are there. Please contact us. Let us know if you enjoy this kind of programming, and we'll try to keep making it available. So on behalf of Father Mike and myself and our cameraman Casey and Mary Ann and our director George and Doreen behind the scenes, I want to thank you for viewing. And stay tuned next week at this time for another program on spirituality.